Yeah. Question.
Okay. So now we start to speak about the seven cosmic laws. And we have to realize that we work with a monad in a hierarchical structure. That is a principal thing. Yeah. And the definition, a monad is a spiritual entity. As we humans conceive it, it is homogeneous. Yeah? Or say it in other words, we don't see any color difference in it. We see just one characteristic. Based on the first proposition of the secret doctrine, there is no beginning and end, so we will never be able, or we will never see the monad as a pure monad in absolute sense. That is impossible. We always see it as the way we are able to see it. Yeah. But still, we have to realize that each monad has a history in expressing his potentialities, because the monad have all the qualities in him, and his way of evolution and grow means that he learned to express all the latent qualities in him. So monads are eternal, unitary life centers, consciousness centers, deathless during any solar mantra. Now, to give you a little bit of an idea, a mantra is 4,320,000,000 years. You have to multiply that by 7, not taking in account the pralayas, the sleeping periods in between, what has the same length. So then you see that we speak about, in human terms, about a huge time period. The monads are spiritual substance entity, self-motivated, self-implied, self-conscious, infinity variations in degrees, so there exist in a huge amount, yeah? And you can say it is the ultimate element of the universe. And if you see the definition, that it is really what say that the center of the monad is everywhere, yeah? And the circumcensus, the, let's say the out circle, is all over, then you can say there is no limitations in it, yeah? So, what I say already before is monads are only observable in associations with other lower ones, yeah? So, if you want to see how the hierarchy of monads is working, you can see here the very famous tetractys. We have the top one, then 2 below, 3 below, 4 below. In total, 10 monads working together. And here you can understand much better what I was saying before. For the top one, the white one, he inspires, he activates in the lower monad that same principles what are latent and laying there, but that are the qualities of that particular monad. It is not the higher monad what gives his quality to the lower one. No, he activates by resonance that particular one. And so lower and lower. And then you see, in this case, a combination of 10 monads working together in the very famous tetractys, yeah? But we have to realize that each monad in that 10 is on his turn another combination of monads. 10 again. And that you can do for a third time, a fourth time, and so on, till infinite. And then you have a huge amount of monads in one huge, this huge pyramid working together. So it is easily understandable that this is gives you a quite complex. This one is understandable, yeah? And to make it a little bit more clear, but then I will show you another diagram, what gives you also a lot of ideas to think about. And that is a diagram what is quite popular in the Theosophical Society Point Loma. And it is really coming from Dr. Brueger. Not that it is new, because if you look in the Seeker Doctrine, you find quite some similar diagrams. Blavatsky was drawing also diagrams to show how monads are working together. So what is known as the egg diagram in our society, you can see that there are a number of monads, yeah, 6 ones in just one vertical line, yeah, and that is just showing a way of cooperation. And then you can see that the highest monad, what is draw, is a white circle, yeah, that is the atomic one, yeah, and then the lower one, you have one monad lower, and then on the left side, you will see what type of characteristics are the focal, or let's say the main characteristic in that monad. And then you will see that for that monad, what is called the spiritual soul or the individual monad, their body is active. That is the main characteristic. So here you see coming together the story of characteristics and monads beings as well. And then you will see one monad lower, yeah, what is called Buddhatman, what is the higher human soul, where lower body and the higher manas is the main characteristics. And one lower, the Pranatman, there you will see that Kama, of manas, Kama, and Prana are the active characteristics. Yeah? So here you see another example of monads working together, and this way of drawing them just in a vertical line is just a way of showing and make clear who the cooperation is. Yeah. So if you look to the other ones, like the take tractors, that you can say is more realistic. Yeah. So you see in our literature that gradually this type of diagrams are coming more to the front, are more popular, are more used in explaining the Theosophia. So we have now seen principles, we have seen monads, we have seen the combination of it, and now we have to go into the 7 laws, or sometimes called in our tradition the 7 jewels of wisdom. That 7 laws, you find them all over in the Theosophical literature. That is no point of discussion. It is a very popular one. But it is something of our TSPL tradition that we group them. And that we say, you have to see them as a set of laws working together, belonging together. You need them. Yeah. And if you study Dr. de Brueger, his fundamental of the Theosophical philosophy, then you will see that he say, if you want to answer that how the one becomes the many, and from that many becomes the one again, that is the whole story of going into lower planes, doing experience, building experience to the deepest points, and then we go the upward arc, and then we working to the more spiritual levels, and on the top we are again what the one again, then he say, if you want to know how that is working, you need the 7 processes. You have to understand the 7 laws, or what we called the 7 jewels of wisdom. 7 habits, what works together, and what is really interconnecting, and by using all the 7 together, you can explain every situation in life and understand what happens there and what you have to do to make an improvement. So, the 7 laws, hierarchy based on consciousness, keep in mind as we have done it over here, and now you will see the 7 laws or 7 jewels. This was the only way to get them on one slide. And then you see that the cycle reoccurrence, yeah, of Puran Atman, that is the Sanskrit word, what stands for cyclic, rebirth, re-embodiment, reincarnation, regeneration, that is a main fundamental principle what you can easily immediately connect with the second fundamental propositions of the Sikha doctrine, the cyclic processes. And if you want to know why do that cycle starts, you have the same question, how starts that movement in the totality? You don't find that answer. But you can say, if consciousness interact on each other, you get immediately a type of process like this. And cyclic is so easy to see in our world that we can give you many, many examples like day and night, sleep and awake, death and rebirth, the year around, the seasons, you name it. Yeah? High and low water situations, etc., etc. And the second one, a very important one as well, is karma, of karman, the underlying law of cause and effect. If there is one law what reflects the unity very, let's say, very strong and very gentle, then is it karma. Because the idea of karma is you have a totality. And if you do something what brings an unbalanced situation in the totality starts to react, to reincorporate the balance. So you can say karma, and we speak quite often about good and bad karma, but in principle there is no good and bad karma, there is karma. And if it is good and bad, it's just from the point of view. If you get a feedback to be more in balance with the totality, that is something good. There's nothing wrong with it. Yeah? And how you act in the totality is also a part who the totality will react on you. Take an account the example. You have a palm in your garden. A very nice one. A huge one. And it is a nice hot day. And you make a run. And you jump in it with a high speed. Then you will see that the water splits and the enormous amount of big waves starts to reflect on the pond, reflect on the walls, come back to you and have a huge impact on you. And the opposite, if you want to go in the water and you do that very gentle and you glide into the water, you will see almost no effect. And the reflection of the totality acting on you is very little, very elegant. And that will happen in life as well. If we act with a lot of emotion and energy on situations and not very wisely, the effect will be very strong. If we are wisely and gentle and see what can we do to overcome this effect, then of course we will have a much elegant restoring situation of the harmony. So karma. And one of the masters is saying, karma is Atman, is unity. Then you understand immediately the bigger picture, what will happens in there. The third one, the lokas and the talas, is an hierarchy and the hierarchical structure of the universe. That means you need to do experience, you have to incorporate yourself in more in the manifestations side, the material side, you can say, working together with the lower monads, experience, and going upwards and learn to be more spiritual. And then on the end, you are sitting almost on the same level, starting self-conscious, ending up self-conscious for that level of spiritual development. So you can see it for yourself. If you look in daily life, you can see I have to build up my experience. So that means you have to do something. You have to start interaction. You have to start cooperation. You have to learn from this. And if you see Svabhava, number four, quite often seen as a difficult one, that means that Svabhava means your individuality. You are a monad, a human monad. You have all your characteristics latent in you, but you have already experience time behind you. It is not the first time that you are in manifestation. So if you are reincarnating, yeah, if you are re-embodied yourself, you have to build up what you have gained on experience in previous life to reactivate it. And what we say, from the moment of the conception till to be in the situation as you was before in your previous incarnation, takes almost 20 years. Okay, 2021 is just a guide. It's not an absolute number. Some people can do it in 15 years. Some people cannot even do it in 20 years, 25 years. Yeah. So in that period, then you are really re-embodied. Then you have really expressed the Svabhavik elements, what you have built already in the past. But then you have to start to explore and express the latent qualities, because you are the monad with all the infinite possibilities. So you have to work on the latent qualities to work them out in this life as much as possible. And that is a process that really goes on till, let's say, seconds before you're dying. Yeah? If you see the other one, Pravriti and Nivriti, what are the Sanskrit terms of evolution and involution? Yeah? And that is in the a special one in that way that if we say evolution, we don't think on evolution in the Darwinistic tradition. We think in evolution as unfolding and outfolding. And that is what you can see, that if you read about monads working together, you always find that the higher monad emanates the lower monads. Some people get the idea that the higher monad creates the lower ones. No. In the first fundamental proposition, there is no creation. Everything is there. There is only starting cooperation and stopping cooperation. So the higher monad starts to emanate from himself, call it energy, call it magnetism, whatever you like to call it, and attract lower monads what have enough similarity in characteristic to be able to work with him, attract them on their free will. They start to cooperate and be a part of the lower conditions of that particular higher monad. And there starts an evolutionary process for the higher monad and for the lowers. The higher learns in the cooperation with the lower one. He has an instrument and he can use that. And the lower one learned from that situation to explore what they have latent in it, because they line up with the higher one and work in cooperation with the higher one. Yeah? And that process of evolution outrolling is the beginning. And on the end of the life cycle, there is a process of inrolling of that cooperation, yeah? And it is a little bit more complex, because if we start the manifestation, we outrolling the lower principles and we inrolling or involving the higher principles till the deepest point, half in the cycle, then we turn around and then we start to inroll the physical and outroll the spiritual. If you want to incorporate all this knowledge, The Fundamentals of GDP is an excellent book for it, to read over it, where everything is gradually expressed. One of the points of discussion is the sixth one, the Amrita Jnana, and the Pratyeka Dhyana. Amrita means compassion, Jnana means path, and Pratyeka means for themselves. So you can say, or I go all my evolution and learning principles and experience for the profit of the totality, or you can say, no, I want to learn and I will do all my spiritual good deeds, what I have to do, because I like to reach nirvana. I like to reach that higher spiritual conditions. Yeah? And then you are able to reach nirvana and you are coming in a type of spiritual isolation. What you can find as the advised and most popular path to go, but the most difficult one, is the Amrita one. And an excellent book writing about all the pitfalls on the path and all the challenges on the path is The Voice of the Silence of Blavatsky. And the last one, Atma Vidya, knowing the self, that means that you are in that high spiritual condition that you have an understanding of the highest spiritual conditions of the hierarchy where you are part of. I say very emphasizedly, the highest spiritual condition of the hierarchy where you are part of, because this is not an absolute expression, there is a relative expression. Yeah? And then you know how everything is working, then the individuality is almost not there, but is really part becoming again of the higher spiritual condition. And that is what is called in the Buddhism, the Tao drop is coming back to the ocean. A marvelous expression that the Tao drop is not lost. He is back into the ocean. He is an essential part of the ocean, but not be visible as a drop, as a type of separation from the ocean. So these laws are very important ones. This is totally covered by our second course, Life Wisdom, to speak about and see all the consequences. The lessons, what I like to emphasize in this and to give with you, is that these seven laws should be integrated as a total vision. The most popular are, of course, reincarnation and karma. But if you want to understand the processes in karma and in reincarnations, you have to incorporate the other five. If you don't do it, you don't understand what have your the reasons that you are coming in this situation. What is the reason that you have experienced this? If you incorporate them as a complete set of tools, yeah, facets of a diamond, seven jewels of wisdom, seven facets of that very beautiful diamond, then you understand that it is really the total information you need. And that is the reason that GDP say, if you want to understand the process, how the one become the many, and how the many become the one, you have to learn these seven laws, understand them in daily life. So the challenge is, go around, see in your daily life, and see if you are able to experience them. I thank you for your attention. We have a break of 3 minutes, then you can send in your questions, then I will answer them, and then we will close with our Gayatri. Okay, Jenny, questions?
Yes, there are some questions. The question is, you said the monad is self-conscious. What then is working to become self-conscious during the upward arc?
Yeah, well, I think we have to start by the beginning. If we have the half circle of evolution, what you can see, that diagram certainly quite often by Dr. de Peruker, but also in other theosophical literature as the Sikha doctrine, that we should realize that we start on that point as an unself-conscious human being, and we go in the matter, and by going into the matter, we have the opportunity to learn and to start learning to reflect on the things we learn. Yeah? So, and on that moment, we will see self-consciousness means that you start to experience yourself. Yeah? You know yourself. You start to learn to know yourself. Yeah? Consciousness is all over. Animals and plants have conscious as well, but not self-conscious. Thus, their particular processes is that we learn to know ourselves. But that is gradually, by going into more dense conditions, material conditions, so that we can more and less to learn our reflection on where we take part of. That is the processes of learned consciousness. If you look in the world of the apes, you will see there starts that process to learn to be self-conscious. They give them a mirror, and some are able to recognize themselves. Some see another ape in their own image, and so on. And there you can see gradually that process to come aware of himself. And that goes on to the deepest point. And then if we go from the deepest point on the upward arc, then the material, what we need to have reflection, become less, and the spiritual becomes more active. So if we end up the half circle on the right for me, as for that Manvantara, fully self-consciousness, we have the spiritual side, what can be developed in that phase, completely done. That means that we have learned to know ourselves on that spiritual level. But keep in mind, all the required elements, we have them always. Every monad has all the qualities in him to become self-conscious. Yeah? So, building up. Yeah? And our conscious experience of past life is an very important element in that process of our spiritual growth and our spiritual realization. No?
Thank you. Then the question, today it seems like karma is moving like a big, big wave. A lot is happening. And if we look at it from a defined point of view, what do we see then? And what could we do to restore harmony or cooperate with nature?
Yeah, that is absolutely sure. That we see a lot of waves going over this world. And what you see is that if we do a lot of things and we don't like to take the consequences and we learn from it, and we correct our way of working, we will only make the waves bigger and bigger. And that is a serious problem. If you look now around the world, we have energy problems, we have, environmental problems, we have illness problems, we have a lot of problems. And the lack, what you see, is the actions we take are too small, too little, and too less principle. Yeah? We cannot run a society as an example where you produce a certain huge amount of weapons and make a lot of money by that and expecting that nobody will use it. So we have to realize that we have a karmic consequence. If we start to build weapons, we create situations that, weak human beings, yeah, starts to use them for their own profit. And we are direct or indirect responsible for that situation. Yeah? If we have a type of agriculture what stimulates a lot of viruses, we should not be surprised that there are coming viruses. What a giving and disease for human beings. So what you can say is we need fundamental corrections. We need fundamental, let's say, different attitudes to use this world. Yeah, and the idea, okay, if it is really going worse, we go to Mars, is of course a little bit ridiculous way of looking, because if you see what you have to do to get all human beings on Mars, you can better put that effort in creating a nice environment and cleaning all the shit we have created. That is much less effort than putting all the peoples on Mars. How many rockets do we have to build? And so on and so on. So that is an impossible solution. So fundamental principles, we have to act, restore harmony, restore unity, not living in separateness. Don't buy the t-shirt for €1.50 because you can know for sure that it is not built and made on a very nice way.
So to change the mentality...
To change the mentality in the world, that is the main thing we have to do, yeah?
Okay. I see there are no further questions.
Okay. I show you another slide. That is part of a slide what I will send out tomorrow. Tomorrow you will receive a handout about the seven jewels, incorporated the three fundamental principles of the secret doctrine, with some explanation and a few conclusions for each jewel. And I will send also some other material, what is needed for the study next Sunday evening based on this lecture. So, as I was saying, look in your mailbox. We will send you some information, not too much, but really, let's say, fundamental ideas. Study them so that we can have a good study together next Sunday, starting on 7:30. Now I will close with saying the Kayatri. And the Kayatri speaks about the golden sun, takes, instead of that sun, the higher spiritual monad, where we have cooperation with all the knowledge there, also able to explore them, and then you understand this Kayatri in a much better way. O thou, golden sun of most excellent splendor, illuminate our hearts and fill our minds, so that we recognize our oneness with the divinity which is the heart of the universe. May see the path before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection, stimulated by thine own radiated light. I thank you very much for your attention.